So, good evening. This is Hromadsky International from our headquarters in Kyiv, and I'm Natalia Huminyuk. And we have our special broadcast. There is a very interesting event taking place in Kyiv. There is the ambassador's gathering where we have all the Ukrainian heads of the diplomatic missions in Kyiv. But we have a unique group in this studio. So we have four our diplomats from the big and major European countries. Natalia Halibarenko, who is our ambassador in London. Andriy Melnyk, who is representing Ukraine in Berlin. Oleg Shamshur is our Ukrainian ambassador in France. And Andriy Deshitsa is a Ukrainian ambassador in Poland. So at this stage, there is a lot of confusions because still there was a lot of buzz within the last couple of weeks because of the Kremlin's accusation against Ukraine. So, besides the Ukrainian fatigue, which is unfortunately is anyways there, there was a question. So what will happen next? What we are expecting? You know, we had a very, let's say, humble comments from Berlin, from France, from the Washington DC. So Andriy, so what international audience and we are looking for at this stage?
Well, we expect the same clarity and the same kind of pressure that we have witnessed in the last months. We expect that the German leadership, but also the leaders of other partners in the West would not just continue that political pressure and continue the sanction regime, but they would probably even try to heighten that these measures because what we see very clearly, we see the willingness of the Russian leadership to omit the obligations that are fixed in the Minsk deal. We see very clearly that the Kremlin is trying to put all the to put so to say the responsibility for possible failure of Minsk upon Kyiv, and that is very dangerous. And we what we have seen, the German leadership sees very clearly that this pressure, which has been successful, irrespective all the claims from Moscow, this pressure needs to be continued.
But Mr. Ambassador, and it's also said that, so okay, Minsk is not really working. What Ukraine is going to do next? You know, we see that ceasefire is broken. You know, OSCE would also, you know, somehow confirm it's broken also, and it's violated both by the pro-Russian-backed separatists, but as well also by the Ukrainian military. So it's somehow, a lot depends on Ukraine. Ukrainian parliament has to vote on, or like is supposed to vote on the different constitutional amendments. So what Ukraine is going to do next?
Well, that's the line of argument which is quite often is being pursued by many politicians in France, in Germany, in Europe and in the States. So my answer to them is very simple. Even if we are left alone, we will fight, we'll defend our independence and territorial integrity no matter what. But for the time being, we are absolutely determined to use all the possibilities provided by the Minsk arrangements. And at the same time, we expect from our partners to continue pressure on Russia so that Russia also deliver upon the promises.
But really, you know, there would be the call, as I understand, with the president of, including the president of the Normandy Group, France, Germany, Ukraine, and Vladimir Putin, Russian president, and
There will be the call, then we shall see. If you are interested in my personal opinion, I don't think that that would be a game changer because we had those calls before, but we should try to use all, as I said, all the potential possibilities of the Minsk arrangements.
Natalia, after Brexit, Britain is pretty, a new government of Britain is really preoccupied with their own things, and as well, there is a Euroscepticism currently. So Ukraine, which is, you know, fighting for its place in the European Union, it's definitely not really on the agenda. So what's London's role in the whole thing? Of Boris Johnson is the new Minister for Foreign Affairs. How are you dealing with him?
I mean, Brexit, of course, changes many things in Britain, and it's quite a natural process when politicians in London, they are more preoccupied about whether there would be a future model of their relations with the European Union. But this doesn't mean that Ukraine is somehow out of the agenda. The political support is there, and the discussion about the prolongation of sanctions in Brussels showed that London was strongly on our side. So I think that there should be some period of reflection given to the British government, but then Ukrainian diplomacy and our embassy will be doing their best in order, you know, to keep Ukraine file on the agenda.
Andrei, so you're coming from Warsaw, there would be the visit of the Polish president, but these days, if you look in Poland, you know, a lot of foreign international experts on Eastern Europe would say Poland itself has its own mess. Now there is a growing conservatism, you know, isolationism, and also even the talks that, you know, there are troubles between Ukraine and Poland because of different historical issues. So it's not really Radoslav Sikorski who is there, you know, on the forefront. So what Ukraine can really expect, and how you would, besides as a diplomat, you would say there are good relations with Poland, of course, because that's something you have to say.
Yeah, I have to say that it's good relations, but it's also true that the Poland perfectly understand that if Ukraine will continue to fight with Russia and if Ukraine continue to stay as independent state, it's a security for Poland. But you're absolutely right that there are different political parties in Poland who are very much skeptical about Europe, European Union, and Poland is not unique. So many countries are have similar politics towards the development of the European Union in Europe. We should expect from Poland, because Poland do understand Russia, we should expect that Poland will continue to support the policy of sanctions against Russia and continue to support Ukraine. Of course, these historical concerns, let's say, will somehow slow down the contact between the parliaments, maybe. But on the level of government and the level of the head of states, the relations are quite good, and there are good perspective to them to develop and deepen.
What are all your concerns? And we have seen the visit of the German Minister of Foreign Affairs to Russia. He's met with Sergei Lavrov. There are always talk that Germany wants to, and German business want to be back to the business as usual, as also the approval rate and the support for Angela Merkel is going down compared to Frank-Walter Steinmeier, and who has a bit of a different policy towards Ukraine and more, let's say, friendly relations towards Moscow.
Well,
what are your concerns?
I wouldn't say so. I think that it was crucial that in the last 2.5 years since the war in the Crimea and then in the eastern part of Ukraine was started by Russia, both political parties of the current federal government succeeded to pursue a really unified line. Also, with respect to this Russian aggression, and what we have seen in the past months is something that shows that an electoral campaign has already started in Germany. The elections have to take place next September, and that would mean for the two parties which would be competing, of course, during that electoral campaign, that they need to look for some nuances also in that very strong and unified politics towards Russia and towards Ukraine, which was surprising even for many experts within Germany. Therefore, what I would like to say, the risks are there because many analysts speak about a possible new coalition with the Social Democrats leading with the leftist party and with the Greens. That would mean that some accents might be changed also with respect to Russia. But generally, I don't think that even the Social Democrats are ready to change that strong course of action, which we have been experiencing throughout the past 2.5 years. There might be nuances, but not for the price of really coming back to business as usual with Russia, both at the political and also at the level of business.
Sebastian, what are your concerns also on the, you know, there are future elections in France. We have Marine Le Pen coming to the, you know, there. We have a bit of confirmation of her connection of getting some funds from the Kremlin. And so what are your concerns? How, why somehow French people should care about Ukraine?
Well, I would say that I am concerned. I'm very concerned. And compared to what has been said by Andrew, the situation in France looks in 2017 much more difficult, will be much more difficult for us because, well, if nothing radical happens, we will see the right-wing conservative politician as elected as the French president, and there are very high probability that it will be followed by the conservative right-wing majority in the French parliament. And of course, people like Marine Le Pen and Marigny, they are well known as a part of what one French analyst called Russian France, meaning the part of the sphere of Russian influence. It's quite clear that we shouldn't overestimate them, but we shouldn't underestimate their influence and the extent to which they reflect the thinking on the right side of the French spectrum, which is much more sensitive to the interests of Russia. They are looking forward to a return to business as usual. And so we are going to be really in troubled, unfortunately, even not uncharted, charted, but in the negative way, waters after the election.
In general, at this stage, sometimes it's not very clear what really Ukraine wants, besides, you know, general things. We need support, we need funds, but really, if you really, to be very short, and, you know, we wrapping it up, and to be very short with this question, you know, but what really the West can do at this stage, especially, you know, at this time, probably, Natalia, when we always ask that, you know, you have so much homework, you know, you still have a lot of issues with our General Prosecutor Office, there are still a lot of corruption scandals, you know, people are thinking that reforms are not that fast, and there are confirmation on that. So really, with that home task, which isn't always done fully, you know, what really some kind of Ukraine ask, if to be really short and finalize the things that people,
if like to be really short and precise, I mean the list is rather short. Like number one, it's sanctions and pressure on Russian Federation in order to support Ukraine in countering Russian aggression. Number two is expertise, assistance, and helps in order to reform our country. So to share experience and sometimes even to educate Ukrainians how to better reform this or other sphere. And third one, I think, is also financial help in order to support our soldiers who were wounded, for example, in the anti-terrorist operation, or even to support families who lost their fathers in the anti-terrorist operation. So for me as an ambassador, I think that's quite a simple list, and it can be easily handled also by the British government, then they really see that we do need concrete needs.
What is your list, especially to know that the commitments, you know, these times we're all speaking that Ukraine should have support conditionally?
Well, what we need and what we do require from Berlin, for instance, but also maybe from other capitals in the West, more patience. We have a feeling sometimes that the politicians they want to see the changes happen faster, as Ukrainians do. Things are much more difficult, and the progress that we all wish to happen as soon as possible is not there. Therefore, the list I would fully share what Natalia and my colleagues tell. We need this help from the Western partners, from Germany particularly, to be more systemic, to be more generic, not just isolated moves of help here and there, but really to have a clearer roadmap. There are some tries to have it, but we still are not so far. We have still assistance in one or other area, but if we look at the German experience, how the Eastern Germany was really helped to go through the reforms which were necessary, and how much funds and how much systemic assistance was put from the Western Germany, then we can easily compare it with the challenges that we are facing towards the whole Ukraine. Therefore, that's something which we keep continuing and trying to persuade our German and Western friends, look, the challenges are there. We cannot manage them unless the help from Berlin, from Paris, from other capitals is truly systemic.
So, finalizing your list, Andriy, you say that you're proud to represent Ukraine this time in Poland, but are you really satisfied with all what's happening back home when you're really talking and, you know, being proud of the country?
You know, you people are never satisfied with what's going on in the country, but there are a lot of changes has happened.
What should be added to this list?
I think that we have to ask, or maybe we have to rely on, if you are talking about Poland, that Poland will continue to treat Ukraine and count Ukraine as the part of Europe, part of European nations.
And what is your list then?
Well, actually, I think that we are quite consistent at this panel about sanctions, about enhanced military cooperation, enhanced assistance in the process of reform. But I would say that I try to hammer one thing to our French and other partners. When you are, we are speaking and you are speaking about sacrifices, about other things, don't think about solidarity with Ukraine, because solidarity, charity is very perishable. Think about your egotistic interest, because the situation provoked and created by the Russian aggression is so important, so severe for all of us, meaning Ukraine and our partners, that it's in your selfish interest to help Ukraine so that Putin can be stopped. If you do not make relatively limited sacrifices now, you will have to pay much more in 2 or 3 years.
Okay, thanks a lot for this panel. I think our audience got something new, and this is kind of a unique gathering in this studio. So we had here 4 our ambassadors from the United Kingdom, Germany, France, and Poland. And we keep you informing about the region.